Welcome. We'll start with our final lecture for the expected questions on education. This is specifically targeted to NET examination. However, some of the yojanas and schemes that we will be discussing here are also important for your UPSC exam. Now, among the education section, we have already taken two lectures. Few of the lectures, one was on school education, another on higher education. Then we took the major schemes and the major important highlights in the education sector, and this is a consecutive class where we would be covering further important topics. Now, some of the important schemes that we would be talking about, there are two schemes and some of the students get highly confused. One is Nai Roshni and other is Nai Udaan. Now, these two are different separate schemes, so make sure you are not confused. When we talk about Nai Roshni, it's the women empowerment scheme and it basically focuses on the minority group. So the minority women are being developed, or there are avenues that are being opened for the minority women under the Nai Roshni scheme, and it's mainly for the women who are trying to work into NGOs, civil societies, then government institutions and so on. The next is Nai Udaan. Now, Nai Udaan is a financial assistance again for minority candidates for those who are preparing for civil services examination. So, under this, from the five minority communities, mainly the Muslims, Sikhs, Christians and Jains, and then you also have Buddhists and Parsis. So, you have these minority communities which would be benefited under the Nai Udaan scheme. So it is to bring more students under administration, mainly from the minority section. The next is the National Achievement Survey done and the various teachers' performance. Now, before we talk about this, let's talk about the various schemes in different section. So when we talk about elementary education, it was the most important was SSA, that's the Sarv Shiksha Abhiyan, the midday meals schemes, the strengthening of teachers training institute, infrastructure development for unaided and private aided institutes, Mahila Samyak, and strengthening the quality of education in madrasas. So these we have already talked about in our previous lectures. Under secondary education, it's the Rashtriya Madhyamik Shiksha Abhiyan, that's mainly meant for the middle school. Then you have the education for disabled at secondary education, incentives to girls, National Merit Cum Means Scholarship, we also call this as MCM Scholarship. Then you have Adolescence Education Program, Girls Hostel, Model Schools, ICT, Information and Communication Technology in School, and various model schools being planned under public-private partnership. The next is under adult education, you have Sakshar Bharat, the State Resource Centers, Jan Shikshan Sansthan, and Assistance to Voluntary Agencies. Now let's talk about the two important ones, the Sarv Shiksha Abhiyan and the Rashtriya Madhyamik Shiksha Abhiyan. The idea is to provide regular in-service teachers training, to give them academic support, to promote more pupil to teacher ratio in schools, provide maths and science kit for practical learning. Then you have ICT, information and technology for the schools, mainly the release of or the introduction of computers at school level, and providing vocational education. Another, there are two important projects. One is the Unnati project. Unnati project aims at improving English language. Then you have Padhe Bharat, Bade Bharat, that's a sub program of Sarv Shiksha Abhiyan, and it talks about improving reading writing in the early grades. So mainly the mathematics program from classes 1 and 2. So that's again important, Padhe Bharat, Bade Bharat project. The next is Rashtriya Avishkar Abhiyan. We have already discussed this in detail. This is a component of Sarv Shiksha Abhiyan and Rashtriya Madhyamik Shiksha Abhiyan. Motivates the child towards science and develops inquisitiveness from the age group of 6 to 18 years. The next is the National Achievement Survey. Very, very important. It's conducted for three classes. Classes 3, class 5, class 8 and class 10. So far, 4 rounds have been done for classes 5 and 3 rounds have been done for class 3 and class 8. The idea is to check out the learning achievement of the students. It's mainly the results show that the privately aided schools are performing much better than the government schools. Again, for the class 10th, only one round has been completed, and since only one round has been done, we cannot comment on the achievements yet. The next is New National Achievement Survey. Now this is done at the district level, so each district acts as a sampling unit and it includes the outcomes in various subjects including languages. So Hindi, English, Urdu as the languages, then you have math, science, environmental science and social science. So based on that you decide the learning outcomes. The next is scheme, which is known as Protection and Preservation of Endangered Languages of India for Protection of Dialects. Now first of all, important thing to note is dialect and language are different. So let's understand what's the difference between the language and the dialect. So when you have this two languages, persons speaking two different languages who cannot understand one another, then these are the exclusive languages. However, if the person can understand the other person's language, it's a dialect. So languages are mutually exclusive. A person from one language group cannot understand another language group. However, a person from one dialect can definitely understand a similar dialect. For example, let's say a person speaking Odia and a person speaking Malayalam would be from different languages because these two are different languages and they cannot understand each other. However, a person speaking Marwadi and person speaking Mewadi might understand each other because these are two different dialects which are having a common root for the language. So that's the basic difference between the two. Now the idea is to protect and preserve the mother tongues and the languages that are spoken by less than 10,000 people in India. It has been developed and implemented by Central Institute of Indian Languages, Mysore. UGC has also started a scheme which is known as Establishment of Center of Endangered Languages with 9 central universities. Seven universities have approved the UGC grants for the research on indigenous languages, and there has been a project between Maharaj Sayaji Rao University, Baroda and Bhasha, which is an NGO to promote indigenous language, and this project has been approved by the Government of India. The next is welfare activities for tribal women. Now, among the welfare activities, the most important is the opening up of the hostels in the tribal areas. If the area is a Naxalite area or a particularly vulnerable tribal group area, we call this as PVTG. So you have particularly vulnerable tribal group area or an Naxalite area, then you would have 100% central sharing. For all other hostels, it would be on a 50-50 sharing, 50 by state, 50 by center. Then the idea is to promote more education in the areas where there is low literacy. So this is demarcated either if the scheduled caste female literacy is less than 35% or the scheduled caste population is 25% or more with very low literacy. In those areas, you have a specific focus on education with free education, free boarding, lodging, free uniform and free medical help. Then you have various scholarships programs, pre-matric and post-matric, to promote more education. Under the tribal sub-plan, you have 100% grant for education, health, sanitation and water supply. Under Article 275(1) of the Constitution, it aims to provide 100% welfare to scheduled tribes in or the raise them in the scheduled areas. The next is Adivasi Mahila Sashaktikaran Yojana. It's a Yojana under the National Scheduled Tribes Finance and Development Corporation. It provides loans to the scheduled tribes women who have an income generation activity, and this loan is provided at a rate of 4% per year. The other initiatives include Beti Bachao, Beti Padhao, One Stop Center Scheme, Women Helpline. Then you have Working Women's Hostel and Rajiv Gandhi National Crèche Scheme. The other is Ujjwala. Now this Ujjwala is different from Ujjwala Yojana and the Pradhan Mantri Ujjwala Yojana. This talks about prevention of trafficking and rescue and rehabilitation of the victims of trafficking. So this is a totally separate scheme. It should not be confused with the LED scheme, the Ujjwala Yojana and the Pradhan Mantri Ujjwala Yojana, which talks about the subsidized LPG. So this is a separate scheme. Now next is particularly vulnerable tribal group was brought under recommendation by Dhabar Commission. So the name of the commission is again important, who has been working on the vulnerable tribal groups. The idea is if one of these categories is satisfied, we classify them under the particularly vulnerable tribal group. So these includes practice of hunting or gathering, zero or negative population growth and extremely less level of literacy in the region. To promote the education in tribal areas, you have ashram schools that have come up, ST hostels that have come up. Then specifically in the areas where there is extremely low literacy, the aim is to provide 100% assistance by center government. A very, very important effort is Eklavya model residential schools. Now these have a capacity of up to 480 students per school, and these are opened in the tribal areas, in the tribal pockets of India, and they are residential schools mainly meant for the scheduled tribes. Again, scholarships we already talked about. Some other developments include screening for sickle cell anemia, screening and enrollment for the schools. Then you have the vacations in the schools would be synchronized with the tribal festivals. So holidays would be synchronized with the tribal festivals and not the normal festivals. And there would be development of bilingual premiers. That means the textbooks would be both in the regional language and the tribal language to promote more education. Similarly, on the basis of the ashram schools and the Eklavya schools, you have Kasturba Gandhi Balika Vidyalaya, which are meant for girls at upper primary state, and 75% of these seats are reserved for minority SC/ST and OBC girls. The next is the various financial schemes. Now, as we said, these financial schemes are dealt with under the National Scheduled Tribes Finance and Development Corporation, and they provide loans at a concessional rate of 4% per year. Now there are various term loan schemes. Adivasi Mahila Sashaktikaran Yojana, where 90% of the scheme costing goes up to 1 lakh at a concessional rate of interest. Then you have the microcredit scheme, Adivasi Shiksha Rin Yojana, and Tribal Forest Dweller Empowerment Scheme. So all these schemes are meant to empower the tribal youth. The next is the Global Center for Nuclear Energy Partnership. Now this was established at village Jasor near Bahadurgarh in Jhajjar district, Haryana. This is the 6th unit under the Department of Atomic Energy. There are 5 schools under this. So each of the school talks about separate issues. So one deals with advanced nuclear energy. The next deals with nuclear security issues. Then you have the radiological safety issues. Then you have the nuclear material characteristics studies, and finally the application of radioisotopes and radiation technology. So this school is divided under 5 heads. The next is the Niti Aayog chairman Arvind Pangaria recently resigned, and he has joined as a permanent faculty in Columbia University in US, and he is the second person from India, so the second top educated literate from India to do that after the RBI governor Raghuram Ranjan, who left the job to adopt teaching profession in US. Now Dr. Pangaria is one of the major economists, and he is a close associate of Justice Bhagwati. Then he holds a PhD from Princeton University. He was honored Padma Bhushan in 2012, and he has worked with Asian Development Bank, World Bank and United. Now the various schemes for the dropouts in India. On an average, from class 1 to 5, the dropout is around 29%, which is very high in case of Bihar and Rajasthan, and extremely low in case of Tamil Nadu. Higher than Tamil Nadu in Karnataka, but still Karnataka and Andhra Pradesh are on the lower edges. So dropouts is a major issue of concern in the schools. Now there are around 2 lakh primary schools that have been sanctioned under Sarv Shiksha Abhiyan, and in 2009 there was a special training to the school children who have missed some of the academic years in the school. Now when we talk about dropouts, how the government is moving forward to check this? Government is trying to provide free food by midday meals scheme, then free textbooks, free uniforms under Kasturba Gandhi Balika Vidyalaya. They are focusing on the residential schools for upper primary girls. Then you have the various provisions for additional teachers, hostels and betterment of the school infrastructure. Now next is quality of school education. Now quality of school education is governed by the improvements in the teaching standards and the learning outcomes. So the basic idea now becomes or shifts to learning outcomes and achievement. So you have the constant monitoring of the attendance through biometric attendance system, which has been started at a pilot project. The next is NISR, the NITSR amendment bill for triple IIT public private partnership. Now triple IIT is important because the idea is to include 2 new institutes of Science Education and Research, that is ISER. There are already 5 existing ISERs and we are planning to include 2 more. These are Tirupati and Berhampur. So these are very, very important, the 2 new ISERs where they are opened. The other 5 includes Kolkata, Pune, Mohali, Bhopal and Thiruvananthapuram. All started between 2006 and 2008, and now you have 2 new that we are planning to start up. The next is the IIIT public-private partnership bill that we talked about. So it's a PPP bill, and the idea is, this was passed by Rajya Sabha, and the idea is to declare these institutes of national importance and grant them the statutory status. So it involves more of state government and industry partnership. They are planning to make them self-sustainable for within a period of 5 years with good financial processes and provide them autonomy. Now, the ratio of the center, state and industry would be 50, 35 and 15 for the IIITs. It would cover 15 IIITs, of which 5 were opened in 13-14 in Kota, Chittor, Guwahati, Vadoda and Tiruchapalli. In 3 were opened in 2014-15 in Sonpat, Kalyani and Una. 4 opened in 2015-16 in Lucknow, Senapati, Dharwad and Kottayam. And then you had 3 that started last year in Nagpur, Pune and Ranchi, and 3 this year in Bhopal, Surat and Bagalpur. So all these are very, very important. The new IITs, where they are opened, what are the prospects and what is the IIIT PPP bill. The next is a special scholarship for Jammu Kashmir students. Now the idea is to move the youth out of Jammu Kashmir who is actually talented and who has a domicile from Jammu Kashmir. So those who have domicile from Jammu Kashmir and are deserving candidates would be given a scholarship if they want to pursue education outside. The next is committee to study data protection issues. Now this was released by Union Ministry of Electronics and IT, and it's a 10 member committee headed by Justice B.N. Shri Krishna, which is very, very important, the B.N. Shri Krishna committee. It talks about, or it has representatives from Department of Telecommunication, IT, the Aadhaar department, that's the Unique Identification Authority of India, and the various academic committees. Sorry, it provides assistance by the Vidhi centers. Now, what are Vidhi centers? Vidhi is a not-for-profit company established under Section 25 of the Companies Act. It's a legal think tank that provides assistance to how to work around with the existing laws, provide research and drafting, and it works on 3 sectors. One is judicial reforms, the other is health and law, and the last is education law. So, Vidhi centers are very, very important. The next is, IIMs are planning to declare themselves as institutes of national importance under the IIM Bill 2017. Now, once they are declared as institute of national importance, they are allowed to grant degree to their own students. They have complete autonomy with accountability. They have coordination with the advisory bodies. They have to drive the institute and select the chairperson and the director. And then there would be periodic review by independent committees in the public domain. And they also will have to place their reports for the Parliament and the Comptroller General of Comptroller and Accounting Auditor General of India for auditing their accounts if required. So that's the development under this. The next is Skill Park. Now there is one of the India's biggest global skill park that is being coming up at Bhopal. It is being sponsored or supported by Singapore's Institute of Technical Education and Educational Services. The motto is with industry for industry. So the youth who is in the private sector and looking for jobs in the private sector, it can train up to 1000 students every year. Now the Skill India campaign was started in 2015 with the idea to train people with different skills by 2022. So 2022 was the goal. Now UK entered the partnership with India for the same. Oracle is building a new 2.8 million square foot campus, and it aims to train more than 0.5 million students every year in computer science. Japan is also bringing up 6 new institutions into India to train 30,000 people in next 10 years. Then there is Japan India Institute of Manufacturing and Japan Endowed courses that are being started. The first of these 3 institutes would start in Gujarat, Karnataka and Rajasthan in 2017. That's being proposed. Now the Sankalp is the skill acquisition and knowledge awareness for livelihood promotion. So it provides market relevant training for more than 350 million youth. the Indian youth. Very, very important section that we'll be covering now. Very, very important for your exam. So the first is Swayam. Then you have the Swayam Prabha and the DTH. So Swayam portal is a massive open online platform. It is based on three principles: providing access, providing equity and quality education. So it's built on an indigenous Make in India project or an IT platform, and it has four quadrants. It provides video lectures, reading materials, self-assessment test and various discussion forums. There are seven coordinators: NEPTEL for engineering, UGC for PG courses, CEC for UG courses, NCRT and NIOS, the National Institute of Open Schooling for school education, IGNU for out of school students, and IIMB for management. So these seven are the coordinators. Now the next effort is the 32 Swayam Prabha DTH channel, which has been started to provide high quality educational programs on a 24/7 basis by GSAT 15. So who would be providing would be GSAT 15 satellite. That's again very important. So idea is 4 hours of content, which would be repeated 5 times a day, which would be uplinked from Bisag, Gandhinagar. It would be, the content providers would be all of these that we already discussed, and InflipNet would maintain the web portal for the same. So it would have three heads. One would be higher education, the other would be school education class 9 to 12. Then you would have curriculum based courses and assistance for competitive exams. Another important achievement is the National Academic Depository. Now this would help you create, and this is an initiative of MHRD, the Ministry of Human Resource Development. So what would be done under this would be all the documents could be kept online. So there is no paperwork that is required. So all kind of verification of academic degrees, awards would be maintained digitally. So it would be digital, online, trusted, verifiable certificates which institutions can take out on a secure basis. The next is Garib Nawaz Skill Development Center. It's again focusing the youth from the minority communities for skill development, training for GST, programming, accounting and various issues. So it's partnered with Nayi Udaan scheme. It has opened up nearly 100 Navodaya Vidyalaya for minority areas and 23 Gurukuls residential school. Again, there is a mega education campaign in the name of Tariq-e-Taleem, which provides quality education to each and every child. And the idea of 3E, that is education with employment and empowerment, is the key. So the idea of 3E is a kind of main idea which is moving forward. Jigyasa, very, very important. It's a student scientist connect program launched by CSIR and the various KV schools, the Kendriya Vidyalaya Sangathan. It talks about classroom learning with research labs. So teachers and students are trained practically for what they are being reading throughout the school. It's one of the major initiatives taken up by CSIR at the national level. Now talking about the minority institutions, a 11 member committee has been laid down to establish minority institutions. The idea is to establish 5 world class institutions for minority students in technical, medical, Ayurveda and Unani fields, and 40% reservation for these institutions would be for girls, and these are planned to start in the next 2 years. MHRD has come up with a new policy, which is no detention policy. Now the no detention policy is now being removed. The idea till now was no one could be failed or debarred in a certain class. However, now this rule has been removed. Till now this rule was for class 1 to 8 and students would automatically pass to the next class despite of the grades that they were getting. But based on the committee reports of TSR Subramaniam and Vasudev Devyani, which talked about the no detention policy, the Subramaniam committee talked about no detention till class 5 and exams to be held only from class 6 onwards. However, Devnani committee revocated the no detention policy, so that's important. Science Express is one of the important science schemes or the science train that has been released. This year the idea is climate action special, which has been brought by the Vikram Sarabhai Community Science Center, Ahmedabad. It has been rolled out into 8 phases. The first 4 were based on the Science Express, three phases on biodiversity, another on climate action special, and this time it's the climate action special. There are 16 AC coaches in the train and it would be exhibiting at 495 different locations. The entry would be free and there would be various sections which would focus on different panels, and the most interesting thing is coaches 11 to 13 would have solar panels on the top of the train. The next is the International Rice Research Institute that would be established in Varanasi at the National Seed Research and Training Center. So it would be modern laboratory to determine the status of heavy metals in the grains and straw, and it would be the first international center in eastern India. Now talking about the National Seed Research and Training Institute, it is run by Ministry of Agriculture and Farmer Welfare. It has a separate National Seed Quality Control Laboratory and talks about the seed testing. The next is all higher institutes will now be taking the ranking test. So till now there were certain institutes who had registered for the NIRF, that is the National Institute of Ranking Framework, but now all the institutes would be coming forward for it. In 2016 there were around 3500 institutes that registered for NIRF. However, in 2017 the number declined. Now it has brought into phase that all of the institutes would be part of it. Now UGC is also planning to provide the online courses through online education. That's again very important. This would be collaborated with Swayam, and universities would offer 20% of their courses through MOOC, that's the massive open online courses, and this lectures would be delivered online or through a kind of online platform other than the online system that exists. So there would be learning anytime, comfort and safety, self-paced and lower cost for the same. Now Professor Yashpal recently passed away. He was a very renowned scientist and an educator. So he is very, very important, his contribution. So he started with the Tata Institute of Fundamental Research, served as a chairperson of UGC from 86 to 91. Very, very important. He worked as consultant for Planning Commission and the Scientific Councils. He also worked as a Chancellor for JNU from 2007 to 2012. Some of the awards he received was the Padma Bhushan, the third highest gallantry award in 76, Padma Vibhushan, the second highest civilian honor in 2013. Not the gallantry, sorry, the civilian honor. The next was Indira Gandhi Prize for Popularization of Science in 2000, Meghanand Saha Prize in 2006, then the Kalinga Prize for Popularizing Science. So these were some of the awards that he received. Now as an educationist, he worked for the school sector and the higher education. For the school, he worked around the various science teaching programs. He talked about a concept of learning without burden. So science should come as a fun. That was what he believed. He also chaired the steering committee for the NCRT, for NCF, that's the National Curriculum Framework. And on the higher education front, he worked on brought about major structural changes. Now, the scheme for children, the various schemes for science. So first is the National Science Congress, which started in 1992. All the children between the 10 years to 17 years participate in this. And each year around 5,000 rural and urban competitions are held. The Indian International Science Festival, under three heads, Science Village, where 3,000 school students from rural background join it. Then you have Young Scientist Conference, where 3,000 scientists join up. And Mega Science Expo, where you have participation of scientific and R&D institutions. The next is NCSM, that's National Council of Science Museum under the Ministry of Culture. It organizes various science fairs and engineering fairs. Till now, 24 such exhibitions have been organized. Various scholarship schemes for women. These includes Scheme A, that's for applied science, Scheme B for societal benefit, and Scheme C for intellectual property rights professional. So there are classified under three heads. Till now, 400 scientists, women scientists have been awarded. 30% of those have been absorbed in the mainstream employment. 40% have completed their PhD while pursuing this program. It's not a centrally sponsored scheme, again important. The next are various international scholarships for women. These includes AUW International Fellowship, that's the full-time study or research in US to a non-US citizen woman. Schlumberger Foundation Faculty for Future Fellow for women. That's again for PhD and postgraduate level, postdoctorate level. So you have the STEM disciplines, that's the science, technology, engineering and mathematics. Similarly, you have MEGRIT, McNarma Memorial Fund for education and professional leadership. UNESCO Laurel for the science awards for postdoctoral and doctoral research. Amelia Earhart for the aerospace related sciences, and Google Anita Borg Memorial for computing and technology. Now, some of the government schemes for educational loans, primarily it's the central scheme to provide interest subsidy. So those who are really willing for higher education and want educational loans, they could get an interest at a subsidized rate. Then you have Padho Pradesh scheme, that is those who are meritorious and from an economically weaker section, mainly from the minority community, if they want to study overseas, they would be given subsidized loans. The next is Ambedkar Central Scheme for interest subsidy on educational loans for overseas students to OBC students. So all the OBC students who want to study overseas would get interest subsidy. Vidya Lakshmi portal, it is an online educational loan system by most of the scheduled commercial banks in India, and after the period or during the period of study, you can slowly and gradually repay the loan along with the principal amount. You have the Credit Guarantee Fund scheme for educational loans, which provide collateral free loan up to 7.5 lakh. So these are some of the loan schemes that government is promoting to encourage education, specifically higher education, specifically in the overseas education basically. So these were some of the major highlights that we have covered for education, and this would be our final class for the expected questions on education. We'll be further covering expected questions in terms of polity and environment in the upcoming lectures, which are very, very important again for your exam. So stay tuned for more lectures on NET. Have a good day ahead.